So welcome to another Cabrini research session. I am Gary Richardson. For anyone that doesn't know me, I am the group director of Cabrini Research, and I am the chairperson for the meeting. So without further ado, we will move to our premier presentation today, which is from Bafrin Sherif. And the presentation is Health Survey of Refugees and Asylum Seekers with an Experience of Immigration Detention. So over to you, Bafrin.
Yes, hi. Thank you for having me, everyone. I am a clinical pharmacist and a PhD candidate with the School of Clinical Sciences, and my supervisors are Professor Suresh Sundaram and Dr. Debbie. So starting right into it, globally, the numbers of refugees and asylum seekers has reached a record number of highs. There are more people now who have been displaced by war and violence than at any point since the end of World War II. And we know that most of these individuals reside in low and middle income countries. According to the most recent UNHCR reports, there will be a staggering 117.2 million people by the end of this year who will be forcibly displaced or stateless. This includes 29.3 million refugees and 5.6 million asylum seekers and 61.2 million who are internally displaced within their own countries. The unprecedented and continued rise in the number of people forcibly displaced globally due to war, conflict, persecution, and human rights violations has given rise to challenging social, political, and humanitarian issues. For host country health systems, the refugee crisis has major implications for service planning and provision. Refugees and asylum seekers may have been exposed to traumatic events, and this increases and heightens the vulnerability to the development of psychiatric illnesses, including depression, PTSD, and anxiety, and also increases the risk for the exacerbation of symptoms of underlying mental disorders. We all know that there is a distinction between a refugee and a migrant, and that the refugee journey is marked by the inability to choose. There is separation and loss. There's sudden movement. It's unprepared. There's a lack of documentation. Visually, it might be easier for us to find Wally in this image than it is for us to find the refugee. Legal definitions of what a refugee is, we follow the 1951 protocol in the convention and its later rectified amendments in the 1967 protocol. And the definition here is that a refugee is a person who, owing to a well-founded fear of being persecuted, is outside the country of his nationality, is unable to, because of such fear, avail himself to the protection of that country. As such, refugees are human casualties which stream from the world's trouble spots. They're driven from their homelands by major crises, and they have endured immense physical and psychological trauma. And very few come out of these experiences without them having witnessed some form of physical or psychological trauma. And so we consider a weak term, the long-term physical and psychological sequelae, which results from this, the refugee experience. Firstly, I will define immigration detention. As defined by UNHCR, immigration detention is a location that is narrowly bounded or restricted, where the only opportunity to leave is to leave the territory. As such, this may encompass prisons, detention facilities, or closed camps. Mandatory detention in Australia has been a key constituent of national policy as a deterrence of unauthorized maritime arrivals. We know globally that studies have consistently demonstrated the harmful impacts of detention, and there are high levels of distress documented amongst asylum seekers in immigration detention. Australia has obligations to protect the human rights of all asylum seekers and refugees who arrive to its shores, regardless of how or where they arrive and whether they have arrived with or without a visa. So, because I appreciate the distinction, not everybody's aware, but an asylum seeker is somebody who has fled their country and has applied for protection as a refugee, and their process or their claim is still being assessed. As a party to the Refugee Convention, Australia has agreed to ensure that people who meet the United Nations definition of a refugee are not sent back to their country where their life or freedom will be threatened. And this is known as non-refoulement. In addition, whilst asylum seekers and refugees are in Australia, the Australian government also has obligations to ensure that their human rights are respected and protected. And this includes the right to not be arbitrarily detained. There are currently thousands of asylum seekers, as well as some who have been recognised as refugees, who are held in immigration detention around Australia. Several hundreds of asylum seekers who have arrived in Australia also detained in Nauru. And in Papua New Guinea. Oh. Sorry, I could hear myself reverberating there. So under the Migration Act 1958, asylum seekers who arrive in Australia without a valid visa must be held in detention until they're granted a visa or removed from Australia. As such, detention in Australia is indefinite, so there is no limit or policy as to the length of time for which an individual can be kept in detention. So when we look at it globally, we know that our individuals are detained for an average of 30 days in Canada and 48 days in the US, whereas in Australia, as of December last year, individuals were detained for an average of 803 days in Australia, and includes 428 people who've been detained for 2 years or more. Fortunately, there are no children who are in detention, and there's been some years before since there have been children who have been in detention. So while the majority of people held in immigration detention are asylum seekers, not everybody is. There are also categories of people who are held in detention. And this includes people like tourists who've had whose visas have expired, student visas or temporary visas, people who've had their visas cancelled, and people who are involved in other illicit criminal activities. So because of that, the figure one here is a bit misleading because it shows that the number of days that people are kept in detention is increasing over time. But if we take into account the second peak, which starts from sort of January 2020, that includes all the people who've had their visas cancelled. So the peak that we're looking at is really just what's highlighted there in blue, which is those refugees and asylum seekers who've been held in detention. So you can see in figure two, over time, the number of people who've been held in detention is actually reducing. So things are getting better in that regard. So offshore processing, we commenced in 2012, and the Australian government has since then sent 4,000 people to Nauru or Papua New Guinea. And all boats of asylum seekers since then have been sent back to Indonesia, Sri Lanka, and Vietnam. And as of the 31st of January of this year, 1,159 refugees have been resettled in third countries. More than 960 have been returned to their countries of origin, 21 have died, and 215 babies have been born. Whilst resettlement options are currently available, under the current government, we still must find solutions for 500 to 600 people who have sort of no hope or certainty in sight. Some of you might be aware, earlier this year, the government announced that those who are on the three-year temporary protection visas and the five-year chef visas are now eligible for a resolution of status, and that took place from the 14th of February onwards. Previously, these individuals were unable to reunite with separated family members, and so that has been a really, really uplifting news. So now moving on to the systematic review, which we undertook, we have investigated the effects of immigration detention on the physical and mental health of refugees and asylum seekers with a current or past experience of immigration detention. And our inclusion criteria was quite robust, and it needed to include participants who've had an experience of being detained in an immigration detention centre worldwide, and for the study to also describe changes to participants' mental or physical health, either during their detention or following on from their release into the community. We excluded studies which were based exclusively on media analysis and only descriptive of the detention environment and didn't draw any inferences to the health status of individuals. The main outcome which we are investigating is physical health, mental health, suicide, morbidity, and the burden of disease. And we've undertaken a thorough literature review, and we've screened and identified 2,512 articles to have included 60 articles in our systematic review with a meta-analysis. And that's currently underway. And Muhammad is here today. Thank you for your hard work on this. The meta-analysis at the moment is incorporating the mental health of children and, who've been in detention, as well as the quality of life of asylum seekers and refugees. So globally detained and formerly detained asylum seekers have been shown to report high levels of mood and anxiety disorders, which includes post-traumatic stress disorder. And previous research has also shown the association between detention and the deterioration of mental health amongst detainees. Furthermore, mood and anxiety disorders are more prevalent amongst former detainees than other asylum seeker groups. And the length of detention also correlates with the severity of mental health problems. Asylum seekers who've been released from detention also report less mental distress than those who've remained in detention, which could imply that a person's mental health does improve following on from release from detention. Recently, Forest and Plot demonstrated that almost all asylum seekers had scores indicating non-specific psychological distress. So that's just figure one on the slide there. In contrast, figure two shows the effects of immigration detention on probable PTSD. As can be seen, former detainees had higher rates of probable PTSD as compared with non-detainees in the first 2 years of the study. Despite these findings, however, evidence of the impact of detention on the short and long-term impairment of asylum seekers has been limited by several methodological challenges. Most studies to date have been patient case studies or small non-representative samples. Others have recruited participants through snowballing, and most studies have been cross-sectional. And that makes it difficult to exclude the possibility that the detainees surveyed experience higher levels of mental distress before their detention. And that's an important limitation given the high rates of trauma exposure in the refugee sample. It has also prevented investigation of the long-term impact of detention. Meanwhile, other studies have showed different conclusions about the duration of detention, which shows that distress could either increase or decrease. And so this is where these gaps in literature are where our research comes in and seeks to address, because there is an uncertain relationship between the length of detention and also where detention is presented as an indefinite outcome and the impact of protracted extended migration status as it currently is in Australia. And that's quite quite different from the rest of the world. That is a factor that needs to be considered. So moving on into our study, this research project is a descriptive, longitudinal, observational cohort quantitative design, and there is a qualitative data arm. We seek to assess the physical and mental health of individuals who've had an experience of detention of a minimum 28 days. And we exclude those who've been detained only as per the Character Grounds Act. So those are the visa cancellations, which I alluded to earlier in the second peak of the figure. We conduct cross-sectional interviews at baseline, 3 months, 6 months, and 12 months, and then annually for up to 10 years. Our data collection methods include individual data through semi-structured interviews and patient health data, including medical records, so things like past medical history, diagnostic information, and treatment information. We're utilizing both qualitative and quantitative methods of data triangulation and using in vivo and SPSS for analysis. Our aims are to assess the physical and mental health status of those with an experience of post-migration onshore and offshore immigration detention, and to follow this cohort up over time, reassessing at stipulated intervals and then annually for 10 years. We wish to descriptively identify and measure medical and mental health related issues, which includes qualitative experiences of detention and the lived experience of detention and the perceived impact of this on past, current, and future health status. I hypothesize that the experience of detention will exacerbate any underlying mental disorders, despite any intervening treatment, and that those with an experience of detention will have poorer physical and mental health as compared with published reports of non-detained refugee and asylum seekers. Our methodology is semi-structured interviews, roughly of 120 minutes duration, but in practice they are much longer. We collect socio-demographic data. So this includes things like age, nationality, ethnicity, previous employment, importantly, duration of immigration detention, locations and times, current migration status, and all other variables which could be of interest. Our measures are quite sound psychometric measures, which have inter-reliability and have been validated in this cohort of participants. So we use the Harvard Trauma Questionnaire, the Hopkins Symptom Checklist, which is a measure of anxiety and depression, the Physical Health Questionnaire, which is a measure of psychosomatization, the Brief Pain Inventory, and the HUDAS 2.0, which is a measure of functional impairment due to health conditions. At baseline at 12 months, we also conduct a structured psychiatric interview to assess the 12-month prevalence of psychiatric diagnoses. So just visually, this is what happens at each point in time. And this figure needs to be probably updated a bit more now because we've conducted close to 250 interviews. So at baseline, you can see that all seven measures are administered. And time four, 12 months later, this is exactly replicated. So at time two, 3 months and 6 months, there's a follow-up, it's all the same, but the mini is not conducted. And at each point along the way, referrals to appropriate clinicians are made where deemed necessary. Our recruitment has followed a stage recruitment and snowballing strategy. So the bulk of our clients come from Cabrini, Refugee and Asylum Seeker Hub. And initially, we had the transitory cohort of participants. So these are extremely traumatized and vulnerable participants who have been released after protracted detention-like conditions of close to 9 years and were referred to Cabrini to primary health clinicians or mental health clinicians. And so those clinicians introduced the study when appropriate, and we then engaged with them. We've also been going to the Shepparton Primary Care Connect through Cabrini Outreach every 3 months for the last 18 months, and we have a group of participants there. Participants have also been recruited through legal organisations and primary care GP clinics, Monash Health, Brisbane Mater Refugee Clinic, and most recently Foundation House, which is the Victorian Foundation for Survivors of Torture. So moving on to some preliminary quantitative data and the initial 99 participants, we see that 70% are male with a mean age of 39.8 years and a mean time of having arrived to Australia of 9.9 years. So that's almost a decade of living with protracted uncertainty. Of these participants, 47% were from Iran, 10% Sri Lanka, 9% Afghanistan, and so on. In terms of religion, 55% identified as Muslims and 25.8% as Christians. 48% were married, partnered. 35% had some secondary education, and 21% had completed or started university education. 58% had refugee status, and 42% were still asylum seekers. Legally, 33% were on the final departure bridging visa E. So just very quickly, what this means is that after the 13th of August, I believe, 2013, the government announced that all of those who were sent in terms of offshore processing to Nauru and PNG would never be resettled to Australia. regardless of whether they're found to be refugees. So that 33% cohort there will never be resettled in Australia, and they must make arrangements going forward. 28% are on bridging visa E's, and these are temporary visas, which give no study rights or travel rights, and they tend to require renewing every 6 to 12 months, and 22% had no visas. 75% of our cohort had work rights, but only 30% were working, because 47% felt unable to work on the basis of physical or mental health limitations. Again, this is quite a young dynamic cohort, but we see that 66% have no study rights and are unable to study. And in terms of psychosocial determinants of health, only 63% had valid Medicare. So that's visually a representation of the earlier figures, which I mentioned. And another point to note here is that of those who had a partner, almost 50% did not have a partner in Australia. And of those with children, close to 40% didn't have children in Australia. So when we take into consideration the length of time, the mean duration of time that people have been here, that is a significant chunk of time that people have lacked those kinds of supports in their life. Clinically, we have noted that there are no significant differences in symptom scores by sex or onshore, offshore cohorts. And women were statistically and significantly more likely than men to have a higher number of mini diagnoses. In this cohort, 73% met criteria for major depressive disorder, 61% met criteria for PTSD or post-traumatic stress disorder, and 21% had current suicidal ideations. Only 18% met no criteria for any diagnoses. And another thing to note up here is that 61% had no mental health or mental health diagnoses or received treatment in their home countries. And this includes symptoms or non-diagnostic concerns of mental health. In terms of the clinical measures, we can see anxiety, depression, and PTSD. These variables rank from 1 to 4. So the mean for each of these is quite moderate, which indicates that there is a moderate level of anxiety, depression, and PTSD in this cohort. And when we look at a disability level, there is a moderate level of functional impairment, as well as psychosomatization and pain severity and interference. So that these are all in the upper end of normal. Diagnostically, as mentioned, only 18% met no criteria in the structured psychiatric interview. And the bar graph here shows and is reflective of the current literature to date, which shows the comorbidity of major depressive disorder and PTSD in this population. Moving on to some qualitative data, which we have been able to draw to date. The first theme is that there is a pervading sense of time in immigration detention as feeling static and indefinite, and that time lost is unattainable. The uncertainty of wait times is degrading to the human spirit. An example of this is, sometimes when I think about my future, I end up laughing at myself. I don't know what to say about my future. I've been in here for 9 years. When I get released, people have to explain the world to me, how things work. I don't know. I haven't seen it. The second theme is that the immigration detention environment vilifies all of those in authority. Healthcare professionals working in detention are seen to be complicit to torture, and immigration detention is viewed as unjust, with healthcare viewed as a state-sanctioned tool to silence and exercise control over detainees. There were two security guards holding my hands at the hospital. I got treated like a criminal when I wanted to get healthcare. You get embarrassed. I didn't do anything, no crime. I have nothing to say to them. I have no power, so there is nothing to say to mental health practitioners. When I get my freedom, I won't need to use any medication. The third theme is that the immigration detention perpetuates an individual's loss of autonomy and personal volition. Hopelessness is seen as a precursor to emotional and mental distress, And the sense of injustice of immigration detention extends beyond the individual to families. This is more so in collective societies. There is a feeling of being a second-class citizen, and the eventuality of freedom is seen as a motive and protective factor for continued existence. My mind is stuck on freedom. It's not interested to study or learn or consider anything else. You are not interested to do anything at all. You are just stuck here, like you are dead. What is the difference between you and me? What did I do? What is my fault? What is my crime? Did I commit murder? Why is the Australian government keeping me here for no crime? Next to me in the same camp, they did it, suicide. I could do it, but I cannot do it because I want to be alive and I want to see my beautiful life. And the final theme that is currently being developed is that release from immigration detention is unsettling, unnerving, and marked with a pervading sense of melancholy. There is a continued fear of the Australian government, and learned helplessness is compounded by the detention experience. The ongoing sequelae of traumatic experiences encountered whilst in detention leads to a hyper-aroused and hyper-vigilant state. The future is seen as a bleak prospect. The last couple of months of being locked up, you forget how to live. You don't know how to be human again. You worry you'll hurt a human or an animal. There is more bad behavior than good. You worry, the situation affects me. I have no idea how to start to recover. I wasn't that mentally bad. You go from zero responsibilities to all the responsibilities in 2 seconds. Australian Border Force said, here's your bag, you'll go in 1 hour. I collected my stuff and cried. You've been waiting and waiting, and then all of a sudden you were released. It's unbelievable. Because I'm a pharmacist, I thought I'd include some pharmacogenomic considerations in this cohort. So we know that 7 to 10% of the world's population are poor or slow metabolizers, but that 1 to 2% are ultra fast metabolizers. And of this cohort, 25% come from Middle East, North Africa, Ethiopia, and Sudan. And so there are certain considerations when prescribing analgesics, such as codeine and tramadol, and that there will be a rapid metabolism into the active moiety, which means that there will be an increased effect. And so there might be a consideration to consider a reduced dose. Conversely, SSRIs will have a reduced effect in this cohort, and so monitoring would be required. Just wanted to thank my supervisors for their ongoing support and expert guidance. I would also like to graciously acknowledge and thank Collier Charitable Fund for their funding and support of this research, and our partners as pictured here. And I've taken that picture at our new Cabrini Outreach Hub in Northcote. Do pay us a visit. It's a beautiful place.
Thanks, Bafarine. That was a terrific presentation. Are there any questions for Bafarine?
Are you finding that there's a common or overarching story vignette for some of these participants? Are there some common patterns of experience within detention that you're finding?
Yes, that's a very good question. So there is that sort of pervasive melancholia and uncertainty that's coming out. And that uncertainty is just really seeping into all facets of life. It's making it very hard to plan. It's very jarring, and it just sort of destroys people's fabric of humanity in the process as well. But these themes are still all very preliminary and are being developed. But there is that sense of people experiencing almost like in the post-Holocaust stages, where there is just this sense of the world being turned upside down and nothing ever being made right again.
And have you had any experiences on the flip side of that? Have you had some people who have had a more positive experience than others in detention? And are you able to theorise why? Is that to do with length of time, to do with trauma they've experienced in detention, or...?
Yeah, that's a really good question too. So there are some positive experiences in detention. There are some people who note that people are treating them very kindly, that the food has been good, that some people have also said, you know, I've chosen to come into your land. I'm a guest here and you've taken me on and you have made a home for me. So there are some comments like that that are being made. Specifically, we've noted that the stateless people like the Rohingya say things along those lines because, you know, home for them is a different concept altogether. And sorry, I'm just getting distracted by the questions coming through. So resilience is also a factor. Some people are a bit more, resilience has been shown to increase and promote well-being in this group of cohort and having those support mechanisms. So spirituality has also come in. Some people have become more spiritual, and conversely, some people have lost faith altogether because of the experiences that they've had. And I might just answer the questions that are coming through, are still in the study. So, that's very good. So Priyanka's asked how many participants are still in the study. So to date, we have conducted 105 new participants interviews, and we've got 112 booked in. And so it says 99 and gradually decreases. How come? It doesn't actually decrease because this is a staggered recruitment and it's a rolling recruitment. People are continually being recruited into the study while some people are reaching their 12-month follow-up mark. So it means that the interviews are still being conducted, and we've started on the 14th of December 2021. So some people haven't quite yet made it to the 12-month mark or whatever. So it will just keep going until everybody is, you know, recruited.
And befriend, do you have plans for any follow-up study or anything that will go beyond this study?
Yes. So in the consent process, there is a point about de-identified data being collected for further unspecified research. And so in the evaluation and the data analysis, where we come across certain trends, so one spin-off sub-study could be to look at the rates of mental disorders in those in onshore detention versus offshore detention, because that's very highly topical, and whether those who were onshore as opposed to offshore did better or worse. And if so, why so?
Sarah here. That was a wonderful presentation about a very vulnerable part of our population, so thank you. How hard was it to engage people to be involved in a study like this? Were people willing to share their time and their story and generally open to it, or was it hard to find people to participate?
Yeah, that's a very good question. I also just wanted to remind people this is a 10-year study, so we're quite ambitious in that this will go on for the next 10 years. We may all look like different people then, but that's the hope. and in response to your question, yes, recruitment is notoriously challenging in this field, and there is a role for vicarious trauma too in the researchers. And so rapport and trust and developing those connections are very important. And so the participants who were initially referred to Cabrini, they were introduced to the study through those clinicians who they've already known and have engaged with and have, had those links with. But it's an ongoing challenge. We provide interpreters, but even then that's got its own set of challenges, especially in smaller communities that are not so diverse, although we're all bound by confidentiality and ethics, but it's a particular challenge.
Yeah, thank you. Recruitment, tricky across multiple areas of research, and this would be one of them for sure.
Yes, especially in this because, you know, we do stress that we're not linked with any legal organizations and that participation will not harm or be beneficial to the legal case. But, you know, there may be a certain degree of them being hopeful that having their voice out may lead to change in outcomes. And there is a sense that people are doing this for a greater social justice and having their voices and their stories written and noted. And brought to the world stage, because for a lot of them, this is the first time where anybody's sort of sat down and tried to unpack these stories and listen to them. And it can be quite a cathartic experience for them as well.
If there's no further questions, then I'll thank Befriend again for an excellent presentation. And we hope that not only does this lead to amazing scientific outcomes, but maybe some change in some of the things that we do in Australia looking after refugees. And I'd also like to really congratulate the Cabrini-Northcote asylum seeking seeker refugee group. I think the work you're doing is amazing, and keep it up. So thank you very much. That was tremendous.
Thank you.
We don't have another presentation today. I'm just going to mention once again the Cabrini Research Forum. The call for abstracts has now finished. There are 60 abstracts that have been submitted for the research forum. The posters need to now be submitted between the 7th of August and the 17th of September. So you've got a fair bit of time to get your poster together. There is a Cabrini template. If anyone doesn't have it, just contact Cabrini Research and we'll be able to provide that with you. The posters go up online and the voting is at the start of October. And then there's the best part, the awards for the best posters about mid-November. So that's all there is really today. I will see you all at the next research forum in a month. So have a great day, and particularly congratulations, Catherine and Northcote. Well done.